Good morning, everyone. My name is Kelly Herman. I'm the Director of Disability Services for Empire State College, and I have the absolute distinct pleasure of introducing you to Kim Russell. I've been doing work in disability services for about 15, 16 years, and every once in a while you get a student who is an absolute rock star for a number of reasons, and I am so thrilled that we get to share one of our rock stars with you today. So Kim is a native of New Orleans, Louisiana. Born legally blind from a rare eye disease, Kim always saw a bright future for herself. That's why in 1996, she attended the Louisiana Center for the Blind in Ruston, Louisiana, to receive tools and training for alternative techniques and adaptive technology to live her life as a high-functioning and successful legally blind individual in today's society. Every February from 1997 until 2000, she marched with the National Federation of the Blind on Capitol Hill and spoke in front of Congress and the Senate to help enforce the rights for the blind and the elderly blind. Since 1997, Ms. Russell has been a member of the National Federation of the Blind. She is also a member of the Greater New Orleans chapter of the National Federation of the Blind. Kim Russell graduated with honors and Phi Theta Kappa honors in December 2000 from Delgado Community College in New Orleans, where she earned an associate degree in social sciences with a double concentration in psychology and education. During her time at Delgado, she was the only student who sat on the Special Needs Committee and was the founder and president of the Disabled Support Group on campus. She became a member of the Omega Nu chapter of Phi Theta Kappa International Honor Society in 1999. In 2000, Ms. Russell was the Eyewitness News Quiet Hero and was recognized as a community leader. In 2002, she was the spokesperson for the Greater New Orleans Disability Job Fair from 2001 to 2004. She was nominated by the Methodist Home for Children for the Blue Cross Blue Shield of Louisiana Angel of the Year Award for all of the work she has done with children. Ms. Russell served as chapter president of the Omega Nu chapter, as well as Louisiana regional officer for the Mississippi-Louisiana region of Phi Theta Kappa. In 2004, she ran for the office of International Vice President for Division II of Phi Theta Kappa. In 2003, she was hired to be the assistant to the Omega Nu chapter advisor. After Hurricane Katrina and the passing of the chapter's advisor, she was named as his successor. Currently, Ms. Russell serves on the advisory board for the Mississippi-Louisiana region of Phi Theta Kappa International Honor Society as the Louisiana District Coordinator. She was recently named the Mississippi-Louisiana Regional Alumni Advisor. She also sits on the Civic Engagement for the Community Committee and has been the Vice President of the Grace King High School Alumni Association for the past 5 years. In the fall of 2014, she enrolled in SUNY Empire State College, where she is seeking her Bachelor of Arts in Interdisciplinary Studies with a concentration in mentoring and special needs. And so, ladies and gentlemen, I give you Kim Russell.
Good morning. Thank you, Kelly. I'm very honored and humbled to be here. Also would like to thank Dr. Tom Mackey, Ms. Janet Nepke, and also three, besides Kelly, Diana Hawkins, my amazing mentor, and Kathleen Stone for considering me to be a speaker here today before you. Also, there's someone else I would like to thank, because without her, I would not be standing here before you about ready to tell you my journey through my darkness. And that is my best friend. She's like a sister to me, and she's also one of my rocks as well. My best friend, who's like a sister, Lori Mold. Now getting to my journey of darkness. You both have raised me up to stand on top of mountains. You both have raised me up to sail through stormy seas. More importantly, you both have raised me up to be that all that I can be. Yes, some of these are some of the words from the song, You Raised Me Up from Josh Groban. But more importantly, these words describe two very important individuals in my life who are my advocates, my rocks, my role models, and my everything, along with my biggest cheerleaders. These inspiring women were my grandmother and my mother. Without them, I would not have the education or even try to have an education that I have today, or even seeking one. You see, I started school in California in the early 1970s, before there was an IDEA, Americans with Disability Act, or even what it meant to be an advocate for an individual with a challenging disability. They were relentless in advocating for me. Well, there were stories I remember being told that they would look at me, family members would say, there's something wrong with Kim's eyes. So when I was 3 years old or four, I can't remember which age, I went to the eye doctors. They told my mom, yes, there's something wrong. They did not know what was wrong with me. So they prescribed eyeglasses that would probably help me to be able to see. Well, they sent me off to school with thick Coke bottle glasses, which were very heavy until to this day. I still have an indention on the top of my nose, which is not fun to have. I got to put makeup on to hide it. So school started the roller coaster ride, and it was not a very fun roller coaster ride. It's probably why I don't like roller coasters today. When I was in first grade, I was thinking back of how things were for me as I was writing my speech, and I really had to think back because there was a time in my life I just forgot. I wanted to forget. So one day I'm sitting in my office, and I come encounter a lot of students, and one of my students came to me and said, Ms. Kim, do you mind me if I ask you a personal question? I said, no, it's all right. If it's too personal, I won't answer, and they know that of me. So she says, how did you learn to read since you can't see? At first, I didn't remember. And it started to come back to me one day. I was writing some notes down with my Sharpie so I can see the letters on the paper, and it kind of clicked. And the reason I say this is because when I started to learn to read was not in school. Everyone thinks a child learns to read at first grade in school. I did not learn to read until I went home. And this is why I say my mother and my grandmother were my teachers. What they would do is, they were very creative when it came to trying to figure things out for me to learn my lessons. They took, I don't know if you all remember, the old time black marks a lot, and they would take big sheets of paper, poster boards. They would write out the words from my readers or any type of textbooks I had and put them on these sheets of paper. So what they would do is they would then teach me the letters, sounds, the shapes, and then associate all the words together so I can make a sentence. So one day in class, the teacher hands me, after my mother would tell them, Kim cannot see pencil, she cannot see pen, it must be marker. The teacher came up to my desk one day and said, here's the homework I want you to do. And I couldn't see it. So I brought it home, showed my mom, she says, don't worry, mama will take care of it. That was her famous line. So after that, we went to school. She would always go to school, tell the teachers and the principals what would happen. So I guess the teacher didn't think, because I couldn't read, that my brain didn't work well. Well, my mother and my grandmother had other aspirations and hopes and dreams for me when it came to my education. So that went that way for that time. Then second grade rolled around. Things were about the same, the challenges or the obstacles, but I was always taught it didn't matter what obstacle or challenge came, there was going to be a way you can overcome it. If you can't do it one way, we'll find a way to do it another way, so that way you can succeed. One day I was in class, and it was physical education, and I used to love to play tennis, and it got to the point to where I couldn't play tennis anymore because I couldn't see the ball coming my way. So my mom always told me, so did my grandmother, go and explain to the teacher if you can or cannot see it. They know what's going on with you. She told me to go sit down. I was being lazy, and I was going to get a zero for the day. Of course, I was hurt. I went home, told my mom. Her famous line, don't worry, mama will take care of it. But at that time, I also asked my mom, why am I the only one in school wearing these big, humongous glasses? She says, baby girl, it's because you're unique. And they don't understand your uniqueness until they get to know you. Yes, you are different, but you're also very unique. First grade and second grade teacher was always telling my mom, why don't you put Kim in a school for kids like her? And she says, what do you mean? Well, she can't see. She goes, just because she has poor vision does not mean she's not capable of learning. So she said, okay. So what mom and grandma would do is if they couldn't find a school with teachers and administrators and teachers to help me, she would find another school to put me in. That way they could help me. So that way they wouldn't ignore my needs. They would try to help me with my needs. So third grade rolled around, and this was the worst year of my life. I was not attacked by the 25 9-year-olds in the classroom. Yes, the kids were becoming more aware of my differences and my challenges because of the big glasses. This came from the teacher herself. My mom taught me how to hold my paper close to my face because I could not see. Back then, they did not know anything about magnifiers or anything else like that, just so I could see the paper. And it came reading time. And during that reading time, I would always try to remember and memorize everything that was going to be for my turn, so that way I could just hurry up, get through my turn, and be done with it. Well, the teacher came up to me and she says, Kim, you need to move the book away from your face. I explained to her. I said, Miss Taylor, I can't. If I do, I won't be able to see the words. I don't care. Move the book away from your face. So I did as she asked, and it got harder and harder for me to see the words. So she came up to me at that time and she says, pack your books, go to the office, tell them that you're disturbing my class. I was really hurt. I started trembling, getting nervous. But at that time, I had to think of an analogy from today of how I felt back then. It was like she put me through a human shredder. All the self-confidence of my grandmother and mother worked so hard to build up in me, she tore it down in 2.5 seconds. So I went home, told my mother, they called her to the school. And I went to the office, and I saw her coming down the hall, and I just started sobbing. She looked at me, and she says, what is wrong? What happened? She knew I wasn't a child to misbehave or act up in class. So she calmed me down. I told her what happened. And she says, don't worry. Mama will take care of it. Then the principal comes out and asks my mom to come to his office. Years later, I found out what actually happened. He told my mother that she had to take me out of that school because they did not know how to help me and that I needed to be in a school for blind children. She said no. He says, if you need more time to think about it, I will suspend Kim until you make your decision. And then remembering back as a child, she walked out of that office with pure determination on her face. And she turned to the principal and said, I would like to have my daughter's records. And I'm going to reporting you and the teacher to the school board for mistreating my daughter. Just because she cannot see that well does not mean that she does not deserve an education, just like every other child in this school. Looking back, I can see how my mother and grandmother tried to rebuild my self-confidence. And the way they did this was, they knew I had a love for music. So they got me interested in playing piano, accordion, guitar, and trumpet. I was getting very good at playing the music, and then I knew then my self-confidence was starting to build up. And towards the third grade, my family decided to move back to New Orleans, Louisiana, where we were originally from. And so I thought, new schools, new state, maybe I can have some type of help. But there's also one other lesson that I learned that I wanted to do and be like was my mother, a fighter. So when we came back to New Orleans, and enrolled in school, I decided to be a fighter like my mom was. And there was also one other thing that I found in myself, and that was my voice. I had a voice, so I decided to take an active role in my education. Fourth through sixth grade, had its challenges as always. Mom would always go to school, talk to the teachers and principal, and tell them about my visions, the accommodations that I needed that would help me succeed in school. So one day, towards the last half of sixth grade, I get a call to the office. I'm like, oh no, not again, I said to myself. What they wanted to do, the principal came out and said, oh, Miss Russell, we found help for Kim. My mom looked at me and said, did you know anything about this? I said, no, ma'am. They had a class that had to go on Mondays and Fridays. At the end of the day, he said, my teachers already know. So he said, you'll start Monday. I said, okay. My mom and I were really excited because I thought I was going to finally get to learn Braille or get to learn some technologies or anything else like that, assistive techniques, so I can be productive in school. Well, let me tell you what that special help was. I walk in his classroom, and there's no one that looks like me. Not a one had glasses on. What this class was, a speech pathology class for children that had speech impediments. And I'm saying to myself, boy, I can't wait to get home and tell Mom and Grandma this one. So my grandmother's meeting me at the door. She said, how'd your day go? So I told her. She says, we'll go and play, and when your mom gets home, we will sit down and discuss it. After that, Mom gets home. My grandma and I talked to her about it. And she says, baby girl, don't worry. Mama will go with you to school tomorrow morning, and we'll clear this up. Now, you have to remember, from kindergarten to sixth grade now, she has been doing nothing but fighting my grandmother and advocating for me to make sure I had some type of education. And this is the reply that the principal told her when she went and talked to him about it. Miss Russell, you have been going to the school board and complaining so much, we had to find something to put Kim in to quiet you. She laughed and says, I will never be quiet because my child deserves an education. So needless to say, the next time that class came around, I did not go. What I did is I just kept doing my normal thing, wrote my lessons out and everything else. And at this time, I was getting used to being in school. I was coming into my own and finding ways and creative ways like they were with me to do my schoolwork. Then seventh grade came and junior high. That's when things started to turn around for me. I met a very special individual who today I call Mama Michelle. She was my seventh grade English teacher. She did something that no other teacher ever did before, and that was listen to the simple request that my mother and I had asked to do. She had me sit close to the board. She had me sit, you know, do the paperwork close to my face, did not bother her. That's when my trust in teachers and faith came back into what a teacher does. And my mother never, you know, tried to discourage or discredit the teachers because they work very hard for what they do. They're very special individuals. But she was coming against these walls that were so hard. So she figured, can't beat them, climb over a wall, stop beating my head against it, we're going to get you an education. And from having Michelle, and from seventh grade on to high school, that's when things started to change. Still had all the obstacles and challenges. So this is the funny part. When I entered high school, I said, Mom, I want to take French, Spanish, accounting, math, and typing. Okay, do it. We got a plan. Your grandmother speaks French. I'm an accountant. So those two things are done. Typing, we're going to do work and stuff like that. So I go to my guidance counselor in high school, and she said, you can't take those courses. I said, why not? I'm just like every other student in the school. I have interest in them. I want to take them. Because of your eyes. I said, what does that have to do with it? They're still there. It's just a nuisance of a characteristic of mine. So she says, oh, let me talk it over with the other counselors and see. Well, I called called back to the office. I was never called to the office for misbehaving. I was always called to the office because I was challenging the teachers and everything else so I can take what I wanted to take. She comes to me and she says, this is what we have to do for you to take these courses. And I said, what's that? She goes, you have to take a psych eval. said, I'm not crazy. Just can't see. So I went home, told my mom. She says, just do it because this is another hurdle we have to climb over. You will do it because when you want to go to college, we don't want anything standing in your way. I said, okay. I did it. The report comes back. And I tried to hide this one statement from what the evaluator wrote on my report because I knew my mother was going to have her Italian and French temper come out. It said that I use my eyesight as a crutch. Well, I couldn't hide the thing because I couldn't see where it was because someone read it to me. My friend read it to me in high school. She goes, oh, your mom's not going to be happy with this. I said, I know. Neither will my grandma. Well, I took French. I won awards in Poetry 1 and Poetry 2 at University of Louisiana Lafayette. I took French 1 and French 2, passed them both with A's, Spanish with A's. I took accounting math, passed it with a B. Senior year came, and I saved typing for last. So I knew the typing teacher, and I wanted to make sure I got into her class, Miss Weber. So I worked out a deal with Miss Weber. I went to Miss Weber. I said, is it okay if I take the typing book home with me so my mom and grandma can write out my lessons with my black marker, and then that way I can do my typing? So my grandmother, she knew how to type, so my mom. So what they did is they drew on a poster board the keys of the typewriter, the electric typewriter. So I memorized where the keys were. So that's how I did typing. I was passing. And during this time, my mom had got a hold of vocational rehabilitation in Louisiana. It's called Louisiana Rehabilitation Services. And that is where I met my very first blind person. He was my counselor, Mr. John. And it was refreshing to talk to someone that understood what I was feeling, what I was going through, but more importantly, knew that I was capable of learning. So it was kind of strange to be around a blind person because I never was around them before. Well, did the typing, last 9 weeks of school, they come to me and say, Kim, Ms. Weber says, we have this humongous book in the front. I said, what's that for? New typing book? She goes, yeah, it's for you. I said, okay, we'll try it. They did not ask my input of what type of font to put in the book. They did not ask any type of they put colors on the pages. They put, and I can only read white pages with black writing or black pages with white writing because of my disease, and I will go into how my disease is in a little bit. So I tried it for about a week. I go to Ms. Weber. I said, may I go back to my old ways? I think I can handle it better. She's no problem. I want a passing typing with a C. To me, that was an A, and I ran out the door. Well, graduation came. I was so happy, so excited. And when they called my name, it felt like time had stopped because it was something I was working so hard for. Now, you got to remember, I'm legally blind, and I did everything in school from grammar school to high school by memory. My overall GPA when I graduated high school was a 2.79. To me, that was an A. When I walked across that stage, the principal, Ms. Rivette, said to me, you have overcome every obstacle, challenge that came in your way to receive this piece of paper. I'm so proud of you, but more than that, I am very honored to have met you in my school. Well, after graduation came, then I wanted to do something that the family told my mom would never be able to do. I went to beauty school. When you do hair, it's only 80% feel and 20% touch. So I did it. A year later, I received my cosmetology license. About 6 months after that, I received my cosmetology instructor's license. I taught hair for about a couple of years, and then I also worked in hair salons. Then I had to make the hardest decision ever, and that was stop doing hair and teaching, because at that time, my eyes disease started to worsen. So I was doing any odd job I could at the time to make ends meet. Then my 7th grade English teacher called me and asked me if I would be considered to be her babysitter or her permanent, like a nanny, her baby girl, Marie, who was only 3 months old. I said yes. Still had odd jobs going on. But that gave me a sense of security because she believed in me, her husband Steve believed in me. That started to restore some of my self-confidence again, because when you have this disease or any kind of disability and you go through obstacles and downfalls, it kind of tears your spirit up. So I became Marie, Celeste, and Margot's permanent nanny, and the girls now today are getting married, and they're beautiful girls, and they're a very big part of my life. Then I was working at Kmart, 30 hours a week, dropped down to 2 hours a week. I called a family friend, and I told Miss Carol what was happening, and Angel. They said, don't worry, we'll find a solution. But in the meantime, while this was going on, I still was fighting the battle of my eye disease. I'm going to jump into that because it now goes to where it's going to go into the Louisiana Center for the Blind. As I said, when I was younger, they did not know what type of disease I had. I was diagnosed with 4 or 5 diseases. And sadly, when I was 25 years old, they finally found out. But the saddest part about it was my mother and grandmother passed before they ever knew what type of disease I have. The disease I have is called Stargardt's. There's hardly any research that's on it. It's the juvenile stage of macular degeneration. And I know everyone here knows what macular degeneration does for individuals that are over a certain age. Well, mine attacked me when I was conceived. So from the get-go, I did not have a fighting chance. So, as they always say, you have to learn to deal with the deck of cards you were dealt with. And that's what I've done, and that's what my grandmother and my mother had taught me relentlessly to do. So, during that time, all of the things that I went through when it came to the eye diseases, of the grueling eye doctor visits, which I just spent a day, and I don't like being there because when I cut out of there, I totally cannot see. It takes me almost 2 days for what little sight I have left to come back. When I was 16 years old, the doctors wanted to do surgery on me because the way this disease attacks the eye, in the back, it bleeds. And my mom says, okay. She says, well, is this going to help my daughter? In the meantime, the nurse is putting the IV in me because he could have done it in his office. Will it change and correct her vision? No. Will the bleeding stop? Eventually. She says, okay. She asked the nurse to please take the IV out of my arm, and we went home. So what vision I do have left, I owe to her. By her asking those two simple questions. Because everyone that had that surgery back in 1982, I have met a lot of them through the National Federation of the Blind, are totally blind today. So every day I thank God for her asking those two questions. So when I went to the eye doctors last year, he says, Kim, I don't know how you're seeing. I said, what do you mean, Dr. Davis? He says, because in the back of your eye, where it should be pigment, it's totally black. Well, me being a jokester that I am, I said, I didn't pay the light bill. He says, well, I don't know if you're going to go totally blind. I don't know if it'll just stay the way it is or just worsen. He goes, how are you seeing? I said, I see you because you're within my visual field and acuity, 3 to 5 feet. He says, how are the strobe lights? And I think you all know what I'm talking about, strobe lights, because the 70 lights, the disco lights, that's basically what goes on in my eyes. It's because they're trying to focus. I can look straight at you. My eyes wonder, and I call them the wonders. So when he told me that, I got up, didn't have my cane with me, like I should have, and I said, I'm not ready to go blind. There's a lot of work that I have to do to help the children that are coming up with this disease, to help them make their lives a little easier. And right as I was saying that, I walked right smack into the door. And he says, so, you can't see? I said, no, you moved the wall. And he's a very good eye doctor, and he's one of the research doctors. And he told me that if there was a way to do the stem cell research for me, I would be a perfect candidate. I said, when you find out, sign me up. I'm willing. So now back to the story with Miss Carol. That's a little history of the eye thing. And she decided to look in the phone book for any type of help. And I knew this was being channeled from my mother to her because of the words she kept saying to me. Although they were best friends, but it just sounded like it was coming from my mother. She got in the phone book and she opened it up. She told me and she says, I found the Louisiana Center for the Blind. Now at this time, before I go into more of this, I would like for you all to please stand up, close your eyes before you stand up, and try to find the person's hand next to you and shake their hand. That is how I learned in blind school, because I wore sleep shades the whole entire time while I was at the blind school, or should I say blind boot camp. Before I went to the boot camp, I went to visit up there. I met Dr. Joanne Wilson, who used to be the Commissioner of Rehabilitation Services under George W. Bush, President Bush, and back then she was just Joanne. And we talked at great lengths on the phone, but that is the second time I was around blind individuals. And it kind of intimidated me because I'm like, am I really like this? Is this my life? I don't know. Because I was in the sight world, but I also had another world that I had to come through. So I went to the center, visited. Joanne said to me after our conversation, when shall I expect you? I said, can I give you a call in a week? She says, okay. I said, there's some things, different individuals I need to do and talk to. I went home, I talked to Steve and Michelle, my rehab counselor. So let's see, that was late August of 96. October 1st, I walked through the center doors. And that's the day that my life changed. The person that went into the center did not come out. I found my purpose. I found who I was. But more importantly, there was one other thing I did. I blended the sighted world and the blind world and made it one world to make me whole. So, cane travel. Yeah, remember, totally under sleep shades. And went through my initial assessment for that blind school. And they said, Kim, how tall are you? Told them 5'1½". They said, okay, here's your cane. And the way they measure you for a cane is by the tip of your nose. I wanted a bigger one. As you get through the travel, you can get a taller one. This is a collapsible cane. This is my car, and it cost me $40. So I did that. Went through the grueling training of cane travel, Braille. I did not learn Braille all the years before. I finally learned it at 31 years old. I'm not the greatest, but I can read grade 1 Braille, because there's 3 grades of Braille. Grade 1 is the basic alphabet. Grade 2 is shorthand. Grade 3 is Mimeth code, and that's basic for the math people. Did all that. I had to relearn how to cook under sleep shades, although I come from a family of cooks, and Lori knows that. And it was very difficult at first, but I did it. And after that, it just made me feel like I was finally coming alive in myself. Then one day, Joanne had asked me, she called me in her office. I seemed like I was getting called in the office all the time. And she says, Kim, I want you to do something with me and a few other people from the center. I said, what's that? I want you to go to Washington, D.C. with me and the rest of them. But there are a couple of people up in D.C. I would like you to speak with. I'm just thinking, just go and talk to just, you know, normal people. We get to Capitol Hill, go to the Rayburn Building, go to the Hart Building, go to Cannon. I said, Joanne, what do we hear? Excuse me. She says, the next person we speak to, you're going to talk. I'm like, what? The first person I spoke to was Congressman Bob Livingston. Excuse me. And he was from my district. And excuse me. And he says, so what's your story? And I told him, I said, I'm legally blind, but the thing that really needs to change is how these kids in school are taught. If they need residual vision, they need to learn it. If they need Braille, teach them Braille. If they need assistive technology, teach them. So he says, okay, take your consideration. He goes, I really and truly appreciate you coming forward. So she says, okay, you're not done yet. Who else am I going to talk to, Joanne? You're going to talk to then Senator John Breaux. Went and spoke in front of him and told him. She says, wait, you're not done yet. I said, Joanne, who else am I going to talk to? Mary Landrieu. I said, okay. Went and spoke to her. That changed. Doing that, I found my voice there again because I was able to help make laws with other blind individuals on children, the Braille literacy law, the adaptive technology that if there's a textbook that the publisher should have books in electronic format for every child, whether they're in grammar school, secondary, post-secondary, they need that to be successful in their education. So when I walked out the center doors, when I finally graduated, I received a Freedom Bell. And it's a Liberty Bell, but on top of it's an eagle. And on it says, now you may soar and fly as high as you can. And that's what I did. So I went home. I went and spoke to Miss Carol, Michelle, Angel, Steve. Said, I want to go to college. I want to fulfill that dream of mine. So that's when I enrolled to Delgado Community College, another land of unknown, another land of leaving comfort zones and walking into an experience and a way to make me find myself again. I was always trying to reinvent myself because I did not know who I was. So I got into Delgado, and Mr. Jerome, who was our disability services counselor, he and I spoke at great lengths, and he says, I want you to work with me on a project that's something that needs to be done here at Delgado. And I said, okay, what's that? I never ask what kind of project before I say yes. I always say yes, and I go about the project. He says, I want you to help me design a special needs lab for all the disabled students here on campus. I said, really? He says, yes. He says, because I know you have different contacts, and I know those contacts can help us. It took us about a semester. We found a location in the library, a room that was big enough that would be accessible for every disability on campus. It was a beautiful lab. Sadly, Hurricane Katrina took it away. But it was something that was desperately needed on campus. And that was also a place we could be ourselves, not trying to be someone else in the classroom. Then Miss Chris, who was one of my English professors, says, Kim, I want you to do something. Here I go again. Yes, what is that? I want you to sit on the special needs committee. And one day I went to the meeting, and I'm looking around, and they're all faculty and deans and the vice president and vice chancellor, we call it down in New Orleans, and the chancellor was sitting in the room. I'm like, hey, that's all. Miss Chris come in and said, am I supposed to be here? She goes, yes. You're the only student ever going to sit on this committee. We changed a lot of things there, too, because they finally were starting to listen to the students and the needs of what we needed on campus. And that's when I decided, I went to Mr. Jerome, and then I went to Miss Chris, and I also did a proposal to the special needs committee about getting a club started or a support group started on campus so that way if we need to vent, we could vent. That came about. Then the opportunity of a lifetime came about is when I received my Phi Theta Kappa International Honor Society invitation letter. I went into Charlie's office. And at first I walked out because I thought he was a student. And then another professor said, no, you get back in that office, that's him. I said, okay. I never walked out. It changed my life immensely because here again, I found another purpose of who I am and what I'm supposed to do. I ran for office for president. I got it. Then I asked him, I said, okay, what about me running for Louisiana rep? He says, go for it. Then I said, okay, I want to run for international vice president of Division II of Phi Theta Kappa, one of the highest offices ever to run for. He says, go for it. He helped me make some of my dreams of what I wanted to do to become a reality, like my mother and my grandmother. So although I didn't win, but I opened up the doors of Phi Theta Kappa for other disabled students to run. I was the first disabled student ever run for any type of office in the hierarchy of Phi Theta Kappa. So with all that, one day Charlie told me, he says, Kim, you do one thing that a lot of people don't do. And I said, what's that? He says, you make things that are very impossible to be quite possible. And yes, you are a very strong, positive, and inspiring role model for disabled and non-disabled individuals who will come across your path. And I said, Charlie, I don't do it for that. I do it to help the others so they don't have to suffer the way I did, because I did enough suffering for all of them. So, in closing, if I was to meet that little girl who started school in the early 1970s, this is what I would tell her. Yes, there are you will have many obstacles, but remember, they're stepping stones. Yes, you will have a lot of challenges, but remember that there are opportunities, potential opportunities of a lifetime for you. But also remember the lessons that you learn on your own, what mom and grandma will teach you, so that way you can grow up to be everything that you can be, especially when you join both the sighted and the blind world and make it one. And always remember that the individuals that have helped you along the way, like Lori, Miss Melanie, Miss Chris, Mr. John, Steve, Michelle, the girls, Angel, Miss Carol, they all see the same thing that mom and grandma see in you. And that is, you can learn and you will have the education that you so desirably deserve. Thank you.
Dr. Michelle Fort, who is a faculty member here at Empire State College, is joining us at the table. We have a couple of questions for you, if that's okay, if you don't mind staying there at the podium. I think one of the questions, you know, you talked a lot about your early experiences as a student with a disability before, you know, the federal laws were passed that required equal access. And now that you're a student, you know, in 2015 and taking online courses, could you share with all of us some of the ways in which you approach your studies and the tools that you use to help you be successful in those studies?
Well, I've taken the online courses as well as the independent studies since I've been here at Empire. And working with you, Kelly, is an immense stress taking off of me when it comes to having the books on format.
Mm-hmm.
Because I can only read, which I don't ever tell my doctor this, but I'm only supposed to read 30 minutes at a time, but I read longer than that if I have to with my CCTV, so that way I can see and do my homework. The professors have been wonderful. I try not to take up I know I'm allotted extra time, but I don't like to do that. So I try to push myself to get things done when the Moodles and everything is supposed to be done by.
Mm-hmm.
Because I don't believe that if I can do it, I'm going to try and do it beforehand, because I'm already labeled.
whether if it's out doing work or wherever it is, I'm already labeled stigma that I'm disabled. And I also look at myself as differently abled. Because, yes, I'm unique, and yes, I'm different, but I can do things in a different way. So that's why I call myself differently abled.
Mm-hmm.
But I think everyone that I've had here at Empire has been immensely and supportive and always encouraging for you to do your work. And my mentor, Diana Hawkins, she's just awesome. And we clicked from the first time that we met on the phone, and she always says that you're very motivated. And I said, well, it's something I want, I'm going to do it. And if I can't do it one way, I'll find another way to do it. But I think having the books that come in e-form takes a lot of stress off of an individual. Whether you're legally blind or ADD, and sometimes you know you have to use different formats for that, but that is just wonderful to have. And I'm glad that I was a part of making that law years ago.
Mm-hmm. Me too. Thanks, Kim. I want to turn to Michelle for a second.
Good morning.
So, Michelle, I think one of the themes that I've heard, you know, with what Kim has, you know, shared with us this morning, and also, you know, from the work that we do with students with disabilities, is, you know, kind of that reaction by faculty. You know, you may either get an email from a proactive student that you have a student in your course, or, you know, you may not know until the Disability Services Office informs you. Can you share with those in the room and also in our virtual audience, you know, as a faculty member, what's your approach and how do you try to work with students with disabilities to make their experience as engaging and as, you know, rewarding as every other student in the course?
Right. So, and actually, I'm sorry I didn't get to meet you yesterday, Kim. I was traveling. And thank you for asking me to do this today. I think that, so I have a social work background, so when I receive those accommodation notices, it's very easy for me to reach out to students first and you know, say, okay, I got this accommodation notice, can you tell me a little bit about how I can help you, how I can help you in the course, how I can help you find some academic success? And I found that that direct contact with students is the easiest pathway. Most students are very willing to share a story to help me understand how I can help them find academic success. And then I think the second piece of the puzzle, so the first piece is sort of open communication. And then the second piece of the puzzle is knowing where to turn in terms of my own faculty, in terms of Kelly's office. I see it very much as a team effort. So I don't own my course, I don't own my course content, and therefore every student's success platform needs to be supported by not only my efforts, but by the efforts of my colleagues. So just as when Kim, when you were describing your grandmother and your mother, sort of, they were almost doing adaptive, accessible learning design on the fly with you, right? And it was a group effort. They modeled to you what it meant to be an advocate. So I feel like my role as a faculty member is to model to students how advocacy actually requires a combined collaborative effort. We're not doing this in a vacuum.
Great. Thanks, Michelle. So one of the things that Michelle mentioned, which I was hoping she was going to, was, you know, the idea of, you know, reaching out to students and, you know, trying to be able to get from the students some of the information that's going to help them. You know, Kim, one of the things that I often, you know, share with our faculty is that if you've met one student who is blind, you've met exactly one student who is blind. You know, that diagnosis is going to affect everyone in different ways. So, Kim, what are some of the things that you would like to share with those of us in the room who work with students with disabilities, who may be designing online courses or teaching online courses? What are some of the pieces of advice that you have from your perspective as one of those students who just so happens to be legally blind?
Well, I know from my own experience, like on one of my courses right now, and thanks to Kathy Stone, she had put all the stuff in Word document for me, because a lot of the colors on the Moodles, I can't see. I'm colorblind from the disease. So if it's red with like a light green writing on it, it just looks red. There's nothing there. If it's blue with like a different type of blue writing, I guess you can just ask the students when you have them or just shoot them an email saying, Are you able to read the Moodles okay without having to copy and paste them into a Word document? So that way, because, you know, if it's, and actually it was Laura that suggested it to me to do this because she said, you know, you're taking so much time and you're getting frustrated, which she's seen me get frustrated already a couple times, that, you know, it's kind of hard because I'm sitting there trying to grasp everything and it gives me a headache if I have to read different colors to try to strain. So that's when she suggested just copy and paste it, put in a Word document, and then it came a lot easier for me to read. I guess just once you receive the email about the, you know, that they have the accommodations and it's okay, that to me, that gives the professor an open door to ask them, what can I do to kind of make this a little easier for you? If there's anything that you can't do at a certain time, let me know. Don't just sit back and get frustrated and then you're getting caught behind your studies. Because it's better to ask a question than not to ask a question. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And I think that's really good advice. And I think a lot of times those of us who don't have, you know, disabilities ourselves are sometimes afraid of asking some of those questions. And, you know, Kim, I think the example that you shared with us earlier of the student saying, "Miss Kim, I have a personal question I want to ask you," is good advice for all of us, you know, to say, you know, we need to, you know, go directly to the source and get, you know, that quote-unquote primary evidence from that student to be able to know exactly how to meet the needs of the student. So we have a couple minutes left. Michelle, I don't know if there's other advice that you'd like to give to faculty about working with students with disabilities or designing courses.
I think the piece about the open communication and the team effort is really key, and Kelly, something that you just said, that we tend to hear a particular diagnosis or a particular category or bundle of diagnoses and presume that that is a monolith, right? It's a medical way to understand exactly one thing or a parameter around one thing. But it really is, I think, incumbent on us as faculty to look at students as individual packages, discrete individual packages, and then think about our course as a space in which those students can learn. And the other thing I'm just thinking of, and in addition to a team effort, the universal design piece, the kind of accessibility that we're talking about, really is good advice for all courses. So we're framing this in a very particular way, and I think during today's sessions, we'll learn that the odd divisions we make between disabilities and those individuals who do not currently self-identify as disabled is actually a little problematic. And I know we'll get into that a great deal. I see a lot of heads nodding, so good. I'm right about the agenda. And then the other piece of it is that just because, I mean, you know, so here's the punchline. Just because any one of us does not identify as disabled today, that doesn't in fact mean that that can't change tomorrow. Or with advancing age, we will not find ourselves needing accommodations, whatever those accommodations look like. So we're hoping to encourage. Yeah.
I just wanted to do a reflection. Yeah. Kim and I have had this conversation.
Sorry. Could you actually go and use the microphone, please, so those on ESC TV can hear you? Thank you.
Kim and I have had this conversation on numerous occasions, and I had the opportunity of working with our 500,000 students last year, and one of the things that I talked with a lot of different students about is that they didn't want the stigma of having a disability when they filled out their paperwork. So they're going through school at a disadvantage because they didn't want that stigma. What can we do as a collective group? I mean, is there a way that we can send paperwork out to them after they've come into the classroom and they realize that they're struggling? Don't give them that one time to identify as a disability, but maybe offer that opportunity one or two other times during their schooling so they're not sitting there twisting in the breeze, for the lack of a better word, and struggling with their education, and they're able to identify as disabled later.
Right, and I agree with you wholeheartedly, Lori. I think, you know, from my perspective
as somebody who, you know, works with students to determine reasonable accommodations, you know, my advice to students always is, if you're going to try to go it without accommodations, that certainly is your right. And know that you can always come to me at any point in the term to request accommodations from that point forward. And I think for those of us, you know, who have had the experience of working with students in courses, it's really important to remember that, you know, just putting a statement at the beginning of a course sometimes isn't enough. You know, and I actually have had several instances over the years where students will get to a midterm exam, take that exam, and realize, oh my goodness, I really should have used accommodations. Well, maybe if we were to think about it as another step of being proactive, of putting an announcement, if we're talking about an online course or announcing in a face-to-face course, you know, we do have this exam coming up. If you're someone who thinks that you might qualify for accommodations and you want, you know, to investigate that, you know, certainly let me know as the instructor or go see our disability services office, you know, so that you can just find out what your options are. I am a huge advocate of students being informed consumers, quote unquote, that they need to know what their options are so that they can make a good choice, you know, and a good choice for them. For some students, that means using those accommodations. For other students, it means not using those accommodations. And, you know, we have to be okay with the fact that students are able and free to make that choice. Kim, would you like to respond to that at all?
I think it's also, too, that if they're in an environment where they feel comfortable within themselves, mm-hmm. to actually go and say, okay, this is what I need. But if they're always shunned away, then they're not going to ask for that help. They're just going to sink or swim. And a lot of times they do sink. They don't go above and beyond that. And, you know, like Lori said, we always talk about it. And I think, like I said in my speech, that I didn't want to be labeled. I've already been labeled all my life, and it basically started when I was born. And each individual walks around with that label on their back. It's like a target, a bullseye. And I think, too, if I like the suggestion that you did, if you need it after, yes, try it this way. It gives them the option to say yes or no if I need it.
Needs to be a vehicle for them to be able to do mm-hmm. that, because a lot of students don't know. We have a lot of students that aren't proactive in their own education, so they need to have the help to be led to where they need to go. And I don't know whether you can do that through the student newsletter or the student newspaper mm-hmm. and just put something in there, run it across your reader board on your website, and just put that stuff out there all the time. Mm-hmm. And it doesn't have to be just during midterms or whatever, but just put it out there all the time. If you come to a hurdle and you realize that you're struggling, please contact your disability coordinator and see what you can do. But just keep it cycled throughout the whole year so students aren't getting to their midterms or to the end of the semester going, oh, no, I'm going to go home to this class. What am I going to do?
Right, exactly.
So, Lori, I really appreciate that point, because it's, as you were speaking, it dawns on me, the students with, so this is not Empire State College related, it's I worked at the Epilepsy Foundation of Northeastern New York and Albany, and all of the all of my clients were born around or post ADA. Mm-hmm. So they grew up with an advocacy, at least an advocacy framework, right, a public policy advocacy framework in which they could even have the discourse of advocacy built in. But you're reminding me that if we're looking at an adult learner population for whom that was not the case, that we need to be the vehicle for ongoing proactive advocacy, because that simply wasn't provided in early education, as Kim reminds us.
Well, especially as we're trending in higher ed
yeah.
more to non-traditional students
yeah.
who, you know, you've got to make sure that everybody knows where to go.
Right, and I think that's a really good point. And I think, you know, it is incumbent upon us to make sure that the students are aware, you know, that they are eligible and that they can ask for accommodations at any point in the term, as well as, you know, to be able to advocate for themselves and to say, you know, this is confidential information. You can get information about this, you know, in the way that you need. But I also think it really highlights what Michelle said earlier about the need for a team. You know, this is not something that is just a disability services, you know, function. This is not just something that's on the faculty. It's not just on our students. It's, you know, a team approach
And that, you know, when they say, you know, it takes a village, well, this is something that also takes a village. And we all have a role and, to play in that village. So I know we're at 10:15. Unfortunately, we're out of time. We probably could have spent a whole day with Kim. So, Kim, I want to thank you again for sharing your story with us.